guys. I'm going to go ahead and get started this morning. I kind of told you last week about the first foundational thing, and I only really reached one point last week, and I told you that I had more I wanted to talk about. And but sometimes we make mistakes, and they leave us damaged, and there are some mistakes that are a bump in the road, and there are other mistakes and other challenges that can traumatize you. And you have to be careful with those, because if you don't deal with those properly, you know, things that happen when you're 12 years old and you're still following, they're still following you around when you're 52, and they'll chase you through life if you don't deal with them. They can be things that ultimately drives the decisions, and I don't know if you know this or not, but trauma and pain don't make good decisions. So I talked a little bit about that last week, and how you can be delivered and you're no longer living in it, but you've been damaged by what you went through, and we've got to learn how to deal with the residue of those things in life. Life is choice driven. 90% of your living in the choices that you made, the words you say, and the people that you listen to. And there's that 10% of where you're of stuff where you're that blindsides you, and you didn't see it coming, and you're dealing with a mess and that you didn't create. But for the most part, is not your life. But for the most part, life is a series of sowing and weeping, or reaping is what we talked about last week. And the world would call it karma. The world of physics would call it cause and effect. But the Bible called it sowing and reaping, seed, time, and harvest. And there's a seed, there's a time you think you got to get away with it, and it came back around and visited you in the form of a harvest greater than what you sowed. And so let me tell you something about decision making. The most strategic decisions you will make will not be after a victory, but it'll be after suffering a devastating defeat. I've not seen my decisions matter a whole lot when somebody just handed me a trophy. But when I'm flat on my back and life has kicked me in the teeth, the decisions you make in those moments usually define the trajectory of the next season of your life. And for some of us, it's a terrible situation right now. And don't let the situation make the decision. Don't let the loneliness decide your next person. And do you see what I'm talking about this morning? See, it's a very difficult thing to do when you're experiencing very negative feelings. And you got to make a very good decision. And you got to understand that feelings come and go, but the decisions that you make will last a lifetime. See, if you can, you cannot let emotions drive the decision, but you get the mind of God on your situation, where you're at, and these are destiny decisions. And where you're going to lunch after church is not a destiny decision. I know it's 11:38 and you're already thinking about it, that the preacher's just getting started and he preaches a long time, but that's not a destiny decision. You won't have 100 destiny decisions in your life. Some of you may only have 4 or 5 in a lifetime, but they can determine the next 10 or 20 years of your life. See, I look back over the 29 years of my life, and I know for some of us that's not a very long, or that seems like a very short amount of time, but for me right now, 29 years is a long time. And the decisions I've made when my heart was broken, when I was shattered, when I was tired, was when I was in a low place, when I was broke, those were the decisions that tend to put me on the path where it would lead me into my next. See, I'm hoping I help you this morning while I'm trying to recap last week and move into this week. I pray that this is meaningful and it blesses you today and that it accomplishes what the Lord wants to accomplish. We're going to be going to Matthew chapter 17. You don't have to stand with me just yet because I've got a little bit more here. But Jesus took three to a mountain, only three, Peter, James, and John. Jesus had the multitudes. There's another place where he had the 70, and there's another place where he had the 12, and then ultimately he had the 3. See, the higher you go in life, the people around you decrease in number. See, when Jesus started out, he had people everywhere. When he got ready to be crucified, it didn't seem like there was anyone there. So I've noticed that when God takes you higher, your circle gets smaller and smaller. Jesus took Peter, James, and John on a mountain, and we call it the Mount of Transfiguration. See, the Bible talked about Jesus, his light, his face began to shine like the noonday sun. The Bible says that Moses and Elijah appeared. See, I mean, something was going on, and Peter jumped up and said, "Let us build 3 tabernacles and stay right here, mountaintops. Wouldn't we love to stay there? We're on top of the mountain. We've got all of this good stuff going on. I'm right here in church. I feel the goosebumps. Something runs down my neck. Let me live right here." And then we walk into tomorrow morning and something goes wrong. See, this is good. Let's just stay right here on the mountaintop. And we feel the goosebumps. Church feels great. And don't get me wrong, it's great to come in here and feel the goosebumps. It's great to come in here and feel the Holy Spirit. It's great to come in here and all of those things happen. It's great to come in here and get emotional and cry. But the emotions are not what's going to carry you through your life. See, a lot of times we come to an altar and all we do is cry on the altar because we're emotional in that moment. And emotional moments are great, but emotions won't carry you the rest of the way. We can cry about it here, but we still face it tomorrow. See, here's the thing is we can't just come to an altar. I've got a whole message to preach, but I feel like staying here for just a moment. We come to a place and we're all goosebumps and we feel great, but then life actually happens. And what do? The goosebumps fade. And what do we have to hold on to? That's why when we come into this house, we don't just go and live on hyped up emotions. We don't just come to a Sunday morning and hope that we get hyped up on emotions so we can get to Wednesday and get hyped up on emotions again to make it to Sunday. But what we come into the house of God for is not just to feel the goosebumps, not just to cry at an altar, not just to sit in our seat and get a little bit of a shiver, because here's the things, the cries, the goosebumps, and the shiver does nothing when you walk in and you face things in life. When you look in the mirror and cancer's in your body, when you look in the mirror and your family's sick, when you look in the mirror and things are broken in your home, when you wake up the next morning and your children are still lost, when you wake up and things are real long, the goosebumps, the emotional feeling does nothing. Come into this place is not about an emotional feeling. Come into this place is about getting into the presence of God and watching Him transform your life. Coming into this place is sowing so that way you can reap. We talked about it last week, but coming into this place and sowing into God, sowing into His presence, sowing into His word, putting forth your time so that tomorrow you can reap what you sowed today. So that way when you wake up tomorrow and all hell's breaking loose and all things are happening, you can stand on what you sowed today and you can pick up the word of God and you can live it out in your life, and you can carry through the rest of your day what God has done in your life. When all else is crumbling, you can stand on who He is. You can stand on His word, because His word is true. That's what carries you through the rest of the day. That's what carries you through the rest of your life. That's what carries you through. Listen, I ain't knocking on nobody. You can roll on the floor, run the aisles, and anything that you want. But here's the thing. That's not what's going to change your life. That's not what's going to change your life. You can walk around that crazy in the church all you want to, but that's not going to change your life. What's going to change your life is getting in the presence of God, is going higher, is getting up there with Him, is aligning your heart towards Him, is developing healthy habits in your life, praying to Him. That's what changes your life. I didn't mean to get there. We got a long way to go this morning, a short time to get there. But Jesus is right here being transformed right in their midst. Moses and Elijah pop up and let's build the three tabernacles and stay here. See, here's the thing. You can't ever stay on mountaintops. The mountaintops prepare you for the valleys. They go back down in the valley and there's a demon-possessed guy. And the mountaintops prepare you for the devils that you're going to fight when you come down. And that is the story that once they come down. I'm only to my text this morning. Matthew 17, starting in verse 14. Stand with me when you get there. Matthew chapter 17. We're going to start in verse number 14. It said, and when they were come to the multitude, there came to him a certain man kneeling down to him, saying, Lord, have mercy on my son, for he is in a lunatic and a sore vexed. And now he describes the symptoms. Oftentimes fallen into the fire and oft into the water. I have to read more, but I'll get to it later. Lord, we love you this morning. I thank you for this day. God, I thank you that we have the opportunity to come into your house. Lord, I thank you for your presence that we feel in this place this morning. Lord, I pray that you would just bless the people, open their hearts to what you would have to say to them. Lord, bless me this morning, Lord, to speak only what you would have me to speak. And it's in your holy name that we pray. Amen. I said I have more verses that I'll get to in a moment, but I won't want you to have to stand the whole time. But often he falls into the fire and often he falls into the water. What does that have to do with the turnaround this morning? Let's roll. I'll show you this. Last week, just give me 60 seconds. I've got to hurry. We got a long way to go this morning, but you've got to believe that the power of the turnaround is in your hand with the law of sowing and reaping. See, I cannot change the harvest I'm living in today from a bad decision that I made yesterday. I've got to ask God to hand me the grace to face it, the grace to learn from it, and the grace to be transformed and changed by whatever the hardship needs to produce in my life. So if you're living in something negative that you created, you've got to have the grace to endure, and it's good because God will give you the grace that is a supply. See, grace never takes from you, it always supplies. So wherever something else abounds, sin abounds, ugliness abounds, demons abound, trouble abounds, grace is all the more abounding. So there will always be more grace than you have difficulty. See, the Bible said last week in Galatians 6, 7, and 9 that God is not mocked. Do not be deceived. For whatever a man sows, shall he also reap. To the man that sows the flesh, he will reap corruption. And that's when he lets his emotions and his wants and desires and ambitions and pride and his ego, when those things drive the decision making, he said something is going to be corrupted. See, the word corrupt is the same as decay or deterioration. Whenever flesh is making the decision, there's something that's going to deteriorate in your life. Something's going to pay the price. He said, but he that sows in the spirit, he reaps eternal life. See, in other words, if you can be in a bad situation but still do what God says, that's called sowing to the spirit, because God's word is spirit. So even though you're hurting, you can do the right thing. Even though they devastated you, you can still forgive them. Come on, somebody. Even though they've never should have said that and they betrayed you, you were still merciful. And even though they hit one cheek, you gave to them, and the other you turned the other cheek. See, even though they took from you, you say, even though you took from my cloak, I'm going to give you my tunic. You've got to learn to do the right thing, even in a difficult spot. He says, do not be deceived. God is not mocked. Say, whatever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. In other words, God says it would mock me if you could get something out of it you did not put in. So pretty much in life, we get out of it the seeds that you sow into it. And God will not be mocked. If you sow the right things, you're going to reap the right things. And I know a lot of people want Bible results, but they won't sow Bible seeds. If you want it to come to you, but you didn't put it in the ground, what do you expect to happen? I'm not going to preach there because I did it last week. But Matthew 17 and 15, the son has a lunatic spirit. His condition to describe like this: often he throws himself into the fire, and often he throws himself into the water. Have mercy on him, because often he throws himself into the fire and often he throws himself into the water. What is a lunatic spirit? Those who keep feeling pain and never change. He gets burned and he keeps going back and getting burned and he keeps going back, getting burned. And after he gets burned again, guess what? He keeps going back and get burned again. See, how many times have we told God that I won't do it again until next time? See, the Bible calls that a lunatic spirit. When you keep causing yourself pain with the decisions that you're making, but you never learn to change, you just keep doing it. Like, you ask yourself, why do I keep ending up here, but you never learn to change, and you just keep doing it? You've been burned and burned and burned. Why does this happen? Why do you keep partnering with people who betray you? Why is it that you keep drawing negative influences to your life? Why is it you keep seeing the same reoccurring scenes no matter how old you are? You just keep getting gray hair and the calendar keeps flipping, but you're still seeing the same scenery all the time. Often he throws himself into the water. He never learns from his pain. Can I keep going right here for just a moment this morning? See, taste the pain of your mistakes. Pain is discomfort created by disorder. We go to chiropractors because if something in your spine is out of order, your left arm's numb, your right arm's hurting, your neck's giving you problems, you've got a headache, and the bottom of your back has a tweak in it, pain is not the enemy. It is telling you an enemy exists. Pain is not your enemy. Taste your pain. What is this disorder in my life that is causing it? When there's a disorder in my knee will tell me that that disorder exists. And it will tell me by sending a message to my brain called pain. See, if there's disorder in my marriage will signal me through that pain that there is a disorder. Something has got to be restructured and reordered in my marriage. Pain is what what's created, because it's the discomfort that is created because something is out of order. And we've got to learn to find the treasure in our pain, because our pain is our master teacher. There's times where you won't listen to anybody. You won't listen to mentors. You won't listen to your mom, your dad. You won't listen to Pastor Eddie. And if you don't listen to Pastor Eddie, you definitely ain't going to listen to me. So have you ever got married and all of a sudden they're about 3 years into it and everything that mama told you was true, and you could see where you're totally blind to, and now what's happening, you're experiencing the pain of it yourself. Why? Because pain is not usually God's first choice. God will usually send you a voice. God will usually send you a friend. God will usually send you a mentor. We'll send you a coach. We'll send you a parent. We'll send you somebody that will usually see you or have a blind spot. And when we ignore everything else, the only thing God can use to get things to turn around is something called pain. See, we don't like that this morning. We don't like pain. I don't know about you, but if something's hurting on my body, I don't like it. If I got a headache, I don't like it. Listen, I don't know if I bet there's any other men in the room this morning, but when I'm in pain, Jess is going to hear about it. When you're in pain, your wife probably is going to hear about it. She's not going to hear about it just one time. She's going to hear about it over and over again. See all the wives in the room and the women in the room say amen. I gave you a free pass. Husbands, you can't get mad because your wife said amen. There was a time I dropped a pair of scissors and it cut the side of my leg, and I talked to Jess about it for 3 days. I said, do you see the cut on the side of my leg? And she's like, I did. I saw yesterday when you showed me too, and the day before when you showed me, and when you did it and it was bleeding, you showed me. And she was like, when are you going to stop talking to me about your pain? And I said, until it stops hurting, that's when I'll stop talking to you about it. But see, I got burned, and now I'm going back into the fire. I'm not going back into the fire anymore. I don't know about you if you've ever touched something hot, but you probably don't want to ever touch it again. When the stove's on and you look down and you accidentally touch it or something hits your hand or whatever, it's not very fun to feel that pain. But automatically you realize that, hey, that was painful. I'm not going to do that anymore. It's the same thing in life. When you cause yourself pain because of something you've done, you should think, wow, I'm not going to do that anymore. When you sin and it causes pain to yourself and to those around you and to your life, the thing is you think, wow, that's painful. I shouldn't do that anymore. See, oftentimes we get lunatics like the guy's talking about. We're like, how'd that hurt? A couple days later, we do it again, and we wonder why it's still painful. See, we have this cycle that's reoccurring over and over and over again. See, I got burned, and I'm not going back. I threw myself into the water, and I almost drowned. So what am I going to get out of that? I'm not going back there no more. I'm not going to drown myself. Man, Eddie told y'all to talk, but I'm going to need y'all to talk back to me this morning. See, I can't stop everybody else from trying to drown me, but I'm not going to drown Branden Shultz. So you've got to understand that pain and difficulty is always producing something within you. If I go to the gym and I'm trying to do a certain lift and I put 100 pounds on there, in the first one or two or three or four times I'm doing it, I might struggle with it. But if I go back and continue doing it the fifth, sixth, or seventh, or eighth time, it begins to get easier, and then I notice on those times it's not even challenging anymore. Why? Because the struggle has caused me to be developed in such a way that I'm ready for more. See, there are things for years, 4 years ago, that would have freaked you out, and today you go over it like a speed bump because you went through what you went through, developed you in such a way that that thing you've mastered is that if it were to come to you again, you're ready for what's next. See, the Bible says, I do not consider these present sufferings to be compared to the glory that shall be revealed in me. The Bible says that though our outward man is being hard pressed, is being come against, my inner man is being renewed day by day. And the things that are going on around you are made to produce something that is great on the inside of you. So you've got to understand, make pain your friend. Come on, find the treasure in pain. Look at your pain and say, I'm never going to be the same. I'm not going to have a lunatic spirit where I repeat the same old mistakes and live in this harvest every day of my life. Your pain can send you the message that something is in disorder, and you can take the law of sowing and reaping and say, I can't do anything about today's harvest, but I'm going to make a decision today that ensures my tomorrow is different. See Luke 15:15 through 24, 9 verses, and I'm going to read them quickly. This is the story of the prodigal son. And Jesus told about the boy who wanted his inheritance early so he could get out of his father's house. And then this boy will enjoy himself, or will submit himself to be a citizen of that country, and he sent himself to the fields to feed the swine. And now this is a boy who was raised in a healthy home. He's gone and he's partied. He's partied away his father's wealth and his entire part of the inheritance, and now he's had to go get whatever job he could find. And he would gladly fill his stomachs with the pods of the swine, the pods that the swine were eating. So when you used to sit in a wealthy man's table and now you want to have the food that you see the pigs eating, that's far. That's a long road. That's a long way away. And no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself and saw how many of his father's servants have bread enough to spare, and I perish with hunger. See, he said, I will go to my father and say to him, Father, I've sinned against you and sinned against heaven and before you, and I'm no longer worthy to be one of your sons. Make me like one of your hired servants. And he arose and he came to his father. When he was still a great way off, his father saw him, had compassion, ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. See, I was reading a devotion this week, and sometimes I think I've heard this compared a lot, that the father and this is the prodigal son is like us and Jesus and God, and that when we stray away and we come back, that God's standing there waiting on us and he runs to us. But when I was, which is a great thing, and I'm glad that we teach it that way, but here's something I read this week and that I studied this week, is that oftentimes we think that when we go, that God is still not with us. That when we're far off from him and run away like the prodigal son does, that God's not there with us. See, here's the thing. God says he'll never leave us nor forsake us, that he sticks closer than a brother. See, the idea of that is great, and I love the way that that's talked about, but I love the idea more that God is with me everywhere I go, that God's with me in everything that I go through, that God's with me in every step of pain, that God's with me even though I make the wrong decisions. He still loves me, and he cares about me. He may not like those decisions. He may frown upon those decisions that I made, but he still loves me. He still cares about me. He still extends his grace to me, and he sets situations up in my life to where I have a realization that, hey, what I'm doing isn't right. But guess what? God has been there with me all along. He's been there with me every step of the way. That God never leaves me. He never forsakes me. He sticks closer than a brother. So this morning, let me remind you, you might be going through a painful situation. You might be going through heartache. You might be going through a sickness. But God is not so far away from you that he can't reach his hand down to you and pick you up and carry you through. All you have to do is realize that God is right there with you, that he's with you every step of the way. Man, I don't got time to be doing all this morning. Yes, ma'am. She said it. Y'all blame her. Your son said to him, Father, I've sinned against you and I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. And the father said to the servants, bring out the best robe. Put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandal on his feet. Bring out the fatted calf. Kill it. And let's have some fillets. Let's have everything else. Let's have some ribeyes. It's all good. Listen, you're hungry this morning. It's almost 12 o'clock. I'm going to make it even worse. Let us eat and be merry. That's what I love about this story, though, is that the father said, that's mine. And because he's mine, bring the best. And that's what I love about our Heavenly Father, is that when we come to ourselves and realize that he's never left our side, he says, this one's mine. I've claimed this one. I know Baylor's got to sleep right now and Jess is downstairs with him, but that's mine. And he's mine. And as long as God will allow me and I can do it, I will provide the best for what's mine. And so therefore, the Heavenly Father is the same way. He claims you and says, that's mine. She's mine. He's mine. They're mine, and I'm going to give them the best. Bring out my best robe. Bring out the best ring I got. Bring out some sandals for their feet. Bring out the best that there is because they're mine. The thing I love about serving the Lord is that he gives what's best for me in my life. See, here's the thing. Don't shout and clap with me just yet, because I'm about to say something that's going to make you mine. Make you mad. Not make you mine, because you ain't mine. But I'm going to say something that's going to make you mad. Oftentimes, what's best sometimes comes through pain. See, you may not like that this morning, but sometimes for you to have a realization of things, there's pain that's in your life, so God can give you the best on the other side of that. Have you ever been through something in life and you turn and you look back and you have a realization, that's why I went through that? Because I realized what I went through that for. See, we were shouting a minute ago. Now you're real quiet because I said God wants to have you the best. And we think that we should get the fatted calf and that's how it's going to be. And you get that fatted calf, but it might come through some pain. You get that fatted calf. I'll get it in a minute. And you might get the best ring and the best robe and the best sandals, but it might take some pain to get there. See, the prodigal son, his father loved him regardless, but he walked away and went through some pain. And then when he got back, he handed him his best. See, oftentimes we think that we shouldn't have to go through anything, that God should just bless us and everything's going to be great in life and it's going to be rainbows and butterflies. We're going to walk outside and the sun's always shining and it's about 70 degrees outside, the wind's slightly blowing, and that's how we think we should be in life all the time. And yet when we go through pain, we get mad at God and turn our backs on God and say, why in the world am I going through this? And yet God is just saying, I'm trying to give you my best. If you would just go through this so I can show you something on the other side of it. See, oftentimes we want to run away from things. and say, that's not what I want in life. But yet if you would just hearken to the voice of God, he says, hold on, my child. I'm trying to show you something through this. I'm trying to show you that on the other side of this, this is what my power can do. I'm trying to show you that on the other side of this, this is who I am. And so then when somebody else goes through it, you can say, hey, Pastor Eddie, I've been through it, and I know what God can do for me. Eli, I've been through it, and I know what God can do for me. Isaiah, I know what God can do. I know you're going through it, but he's done it for me, and he can do it for you. And he can do it for you, and you, and you, and you. And the thing is God is trying to show you something in your life. So that way you can take what you've been through and go out of these doors and tell that world, those outside of the four walls of the church, that, hey, I know what it is you're going through, but there's a God who loves you, a God who cares about you, that can get you through it to the other side. Bring the fatted calf here. See, my son who was dead is alive and lost is now found. And they began to eat and be merry. In my opinion, this is one of the greatest stories in the Bible. But he had to come to himself. See, the father did not aid him in his pain. Parents, listen to me this morning. You cannot keep intercepting your children's negative harvest that the pain of their decision was sent to change them and not you. People never change when they never feel the responsibilities and consequences of their decisions. See, your children are often throwing themselves into the fire and often throwing themselves into the water. Why? Because they throw themselves into the fire, but daddy gets burned. See, some of you look like you're struggling with me this morning because you're being real quiet. You just need to saddle this pony up and ride it with me. He came to himself, and his daddy was not there to feed him. His daddy was not there to bail him out. His daddy did not intercept the pain. Why? Because when you hurt bad enough, you come to yourself, and you what? You arise. See, the Bible said he came to himself, and he said, I will arise. Sometimes if somebody really hits the bottom, you ain't got to pull them up. They'll pull themselves up and say, it's better where I used to be than where I am now, and I'm going to make my way back. When God reaches his hand down, I'm going to pick myself up out of this. See, we do deal with irresponsibility, but sometimes you're guilty of being over responsible. See, and you take responsibility for the harvests that are not yours. And I'm going to tell you what those people do that leads to bitterness and resentment, because they keep dealing with everybody else's fallout, and the fallout was never assigned to them in the first place. See, pain was sent to change the person that was causing the problem. The whole thing about being burned is if you don't ever want to be burned again. I don't know that I've ever met anybody that got burnt and said, I want to be burned again. I don't know anybody who's ever touched something hot and said, wow, that felt great. I want to do that again. Y'all quiet on me this morning. Y'all really want me to hurry up, but I'm going to take longer because you being quiet. A couple of you said, oh, Lord, I got to start talking to him. See, pain was sent to change the person that was causing the problem. See, I think one of the greatest qualities is what I call self-awareness. A self-aware person knows their strengths and knows their weaknesses. When you're self-aware, nobody else has to correct you. But the people that are not self-aware, people always have to come and correct them. See, one thing I'm amazed about in life is people who think they can sing. Notice I said think. There's a reason I sit on the front row and stand there and sing. There's a reason I don't get in the choir and sing. The Bible says lift up a joyful noise, and I'm glad that it's joyful to the Lord. But sometimes you need to do that from your pew. I ain't trying to tell you get out of the choir. If you're in the choir, I'm not harping on April. April giving me dirty looks. But go still be in the choir. You can sing and look pretty up there. But some of us, we just need to stay in the pew and worship Jesus from down there. Right where we're at. See, y'all quiet. Y'all like me this morning. That's okay. But the Bible says lift up a joyful noise. See, no one smells their own stink. You smell everybody else's, but you don't know when you're walking in the room and stinking it up. See, the thing I like about the prodigal son is that he came to himself. He understood that I made a mistake. Oftentimes, we walk in and we want to look at everybody else's stink and not our own stink. Well, did you see what they're wearing today? Did you see how they fell asleep in church today? Don't worry, if you're asleep, I ain't looking at you. Did you see what they were doing? Did you see how they were acting? My Lord, what are you doing? You're doing just as bad as they are by running your mouth and gossiping about it. We got our own stink we need to deal with. Listen, I don't know about you, but I got enough of my own self that I need to deal with, that I need to go to an altar and pray about, let alone worry about what you got going on in your life. Don't take that the wrong way. I want to pray for you and be there for you. That's what we're here to do. But I don't need to worry about your problems. I got my own to deal with. See, oftentimes people walk up, man, I got, oh, Lord, we got to hurry. But oftentimes we sit in our pew and somebody goes to the altar and we lean over. Yep, they should be up there. Or we lean over and go, what are they up there for again this week? Let me tell you something this morning. If you got to ride the altar to heaven, baby, you ride the altar to heaven. Do what you got to do to get there. I don't care if you prayed about it last week. You come pray about it again this week. Because the thing is when I walk into the gates, because, Lord, I hope I make it and I get there. But when I walk into the gates, I want to see your beautiful face there. So if you got to ride the altar to get there, baby, you ride the altar to get there. If you got to pray about it this week, pray about it next week and the next week and the next week. Baby, you get to the altar and you pray about it. And you do what you need to do to get there. The thing is we shouldn't be sitting there judging them. We should walk right up here and get right down beside them and say, I don't know what you're going through, but here's the thing. I'm going to walk through it with you. I'm going to go through it with you because we all got problems. We all got messes. We all got things we got to deal with. Number one, confess your mistake to you. I promise. I'm trying to hurry. So you say, I messed up. So you can't turn it around if it's always somebody else's fault. If it's their fault, guess what you did? You put the power in their hands to turn it around. If it's your fault, then it's up to you to turn it around. See, the devil is a lie. If I'm going to sit here and wait 20 years for you to apologize to me, I'm letting you go. I'm not giving you that kind of power and hold in my life. If you apologize, that's gravy on top. But here's what you do when somebody has wronged you. You've got to understand that the blood of Jesus was not just for payment of your sins. It was payment for everyone who has ever sinned against you. See, the second thing you've got to do is confession. Confess your mistake to God. Confess it to yourself. Come to yourself. Be self-aware and arise from this place and say, this is enough. I've been burned enough. And then confess it to God. See, because the Bible says he is faithful and just to forgive all of your sins and cleanse you from all of unrighteousness. See, the third thing you got to do now is where they really take some intestinal fortitude. You've got to confess to people who may have been wronged by your decisions. Jesus says, if you brought a gift on the altar and give it to God, and he said, but your brother is ought with you, he said, leave your gift. I'm going to make peace with your brother. And then once you've made peace, come back and offer your gift. Can you give me 5 more minutes? I'm going to try to get there. Maybe if Miss Elva comes and plays softly and you stand, it'll go quicker. Might I ask what alternatives were available to you at the time of your mistake? Luke 14, and I'll quit here. We got things planned for the next couple of weeks, but I'll come back to this. Luke 14 and 28, for which of you intending to build a tower does not sit down and first count the cost, whether he has enough to finish it, lest after he's laid the foundation and not able to finish. All who see it begin to mock him. This man began to build and was it not able to finish? Or what king is going to make war against another king does not sit down first and consider whether he is able with 10,000 to meet him who has come against him with 20,000, while the other side is still far off? If he sends a delegation and ask for conditions of peace. See, while you're reviewing your mistake, the power of sowing and reaping is in your hand. Be willing to taste the pain and find treasure in the pain. See, admit the mistake to yourself. Admit the mistake to God and seek restitution to anyone else who may be harmed. Assign the responsibility of the mistake properly and then examine what alternatives did you have when you messed up. See, a lot of times in life, we continue to repeat things over and over again because we don't look at it and say, what got me to this position? What got me to where I am? What put me here? We don't evaluate, so we continue to go back and be burned again and again. We continue to go back and throw ourselves into the water again and again. Why? Because we don't evaluate and look back and say, how in the world did I get here? What put me in this position? There is no recipe for ruin than what we just read right there. Who intending does not first sit down and count the cost. count the cost. I want to leave you with this morning. Who are the people that are influencing you at the time you're a mistake? Who had your ear? Because whoever has your ear has your future. The Bible says to incline your heart to the Father. Whoever has your ear has influence over your life. Who are you listening to? We talked about it a couple weeks ago in Sunday school. Who are you listening to? I preached about it a couple weeks ago as well. Who are you listening to? Are you listening to what the enemy says about you, or are you listening to what the voice of God says about you? Are you listening to where the enemy says you can't do it and you won't be healed, or are you listening to what God says about you? Are you listening to what he says? Are you listening to the enemy that says your children will never come home? Your children will never be saved. You'll never see them in the church. Are you listening to what the Father says? Are you inclining your voice? Are you inclining your heart to him and listening to his voice in your life? When you go through pain, are you listening to the enemy saying it's painful, it's always going to be this way? Are you listening to the voice of God that says, I see you where you are? You can either look back on this and reflect and see what God's trying to do, what he's trying to do in your life, or you can continue to repeat the pattern. Who has your ear? This morning, as they're about to sing, who has your ear? Maybe you're in this room this morning and you've got sin in your life and you've never come to an altar and given your life to God before. You've never asked him into your heart. You've never asked for the blood of Jesus to wash your sins away. I want you to know that this morning's your morning. Today's your day.